Reason number 3. Big upfront planning is not practical. Because we assume we can collect all the requirements in the beginning, and because we assume we can freeze the requirements and it did not have to change later, we also assume we can plan everything upfront. So, is it possible? So, what are the assumptions? Why do we assume this way? We assume software is so simple that development can be planned from beginning to end without any problem. And we also assume all project variables can be estimated or predicted in the beginning. Project variables could be your scope, your size, your cost, your resources, your schedule, your risks, everything. All software variables or project variables we assume can be predicted in the beginning. And we also assume upfront planning is possible and upfront planning is enough. We may make some minor changes to the plan, but most of those planning has been done in the beginning because we believe it is possible. So, what we do? We prepare a detailed plan in the beginning. If it is a 1 year project, we also plan what should developer A should do after 180 days from now. What should the tester do, say 240 days from now? So we plan everything in the beginning and we strictly track to the plan. We may adjust here and there somewhere, but primarily we use the main plan. So what is the reality? In reality, big upfront planning is difficult. Planning should also evolve along with your requirements. Say when you cannot freeze the requirements, you cannot freeze the plan also. The result? Okay, this is a huge set of results and there is a big survey on this result itself. So I cannot just explain that result in just one word in the slide. Let's move on and see what are the implications of this assumption. Big upfront planning is possible. That is an assumption we have. So let's go back to the Standish report which we mentioned earlier. So the Standish group came up with a Kios report. They did an analysis or survey with about 365 respondents, primarily the senior managers of various software projects, both small, medium and large companies. And they covered major industry segments, healthcare, insurance, banking, all those stuff. And more than 8,000 projects have been surveyed in this particular Standish group survey. And they call this survey result as Kios report. And some people do not like that word because it is on negative context. It's also called failure report. This is the findings. After they've done that survey, they categorized the set of projects into three major groups. The first group of projects are successful projects. So the Standish group definition of success: if the project is completed on time and on budget with all the features and functions as initially specified. If all the three things happen, it is called a successful project. The second set of projects, challenged projects. The project is completed, but it is over budget, behind schedule, and it does not offer all the features and functions originally specified. It does not have something, missed something. So if that is the case, those categories of projects are called challenged projects. And the third category, impaired projects. These projects are cancelled halfway through, or these projects have never reached the client. So stopped somewhere down the line. So these are all the three categories, and they've also come up with percentage of projects in these three categories. So before I come up with that percentage, let me ask you, based on your experience, what percentage of projects have been successful in your company? 80%, 50%, 40%, 30%, 33%, one-third of the projects. Let's see what the survey result says. 16.2%, probably one-sixth of the projects. Only those percentage of projects have been successful. And close to 50% of the projects, 52.7% of the projects are impaired. They have been delivered, but behind schedule, with extra cost, and not with all the features. So 52.7% of the projects have been challenged. And interestingly, about 31.1% of the projects have never reached the customer. After incurring a lot of cost, it has never seen the light of the day. It is really shocking. In fact, when Standish Group released this survey somewhere in 1995, almost the entire software industry is stunned. Some people do not even believe this. Some people even question the data. You can dispute the numbers, but you cannot dispute the three categories of projects, and you cannot dispute the fact that the successful projects are very, very less compared to other two buckets of projects. Now, Standish Group also came up with the success factors. Those three factors, right? Successful projects, challenged projects, failed projects. They also came up with the reasons or factors for the successful projects as well as challenged projects as well as impaired projects. So let's look at the first list. What are the reasons for projects being successful? I'll ask you, what are the reasons based on your experience for some projects to be successful? On time, on schedule, with all the original features, with no extra cost. If you have ever delivered projects like that, what are the reasons? Or if you have not done, if you do certain things right, you can do this. What are the reasons? As per Standish Group report, this is what it is. The first and foremost, user involvement throughout the life cycle. Second one, executive management support. And the third one, clear statement of requirements. And planning comes slightly later, realistic expectations, and the list goes on. But the topmost one is user involvement and executive management support. Same way, they also came up with the project challenge factors. Here are they. Lack of user input, that is the first major reason for challenged projects. Incomplete requirements and specifications, changing requirements and specifications, lack of executive support, some of them are repeated from the first list. And they also came up with the reason for impaired projects. So here are the reasons. Incomplete requirements, that is the major reason for projects to be cancelled. And lack of user involvement, that comes throughout in the top two or three. Lack of resources, unrealistic expectations, and all those stuff. I'm sure many of these factors do happen in your projects, at least some of the projects. Now, you may even ask me, what is that you are talking about? You are talking about a 1995 report. Things have changed a lot in the last 15 years. And I'm sure if you take a survey today, the things would have been much different. Our projects do not have only 16% success. Unfortunately, Standish Group keep on doing this survey every year. Only the 1995 report is the most quoted report. If you go to any website or any result or any survey, you find 1995 report. But otherwise, they come up with this report almost every year. So look at the successful projects. It has marginally increased from 16% to say 30%. So look at absolute percentage of this, probably it has doubled from 16% to 32%, somewhere around that. But it is still 1/3 of projects are completely successful. Take the challenge projects, they waver around. So no major changes, no major improvements. And failed projects, that also waver around and coming down. It has come down a bit, but still it is not something which we can feel comfortable with. So things have not improved much over a period of time. Now, we have been talking about the failure report. Are there any success reports? So here are some. So this Dr. Dobbs survey, they did what are all the factors for projects to be successful. So here are the results of that successful projects. Let me remind once again, this is the survey of successful projects. So keep this in mind, we will revisit these points later after we complete all those 7 reasons.